Hello friends, in the fourth lecture of analysis of a simple truss, we will continue with the flow, that is internal resistance in the members and assumptions made in the analysis of a plane truss. So last time what we did was truss, beam and frame, distinguish between beam and truss, types of truss, and we also discussed the components of a roof truss. So as per the content, we'll continue with internal resistance of a members, or we can say internal resistance, or we can say internal stresses in the members. So we'll be talking about what are some of the internal stresses that are compressive or tensile taking place in the members, because as discussed earlier, we know that in a members of the truss, there are only tension and only compressions acting. There are no any other force such as shear force, bending moment, etc. Because there are no lateral loads. Only longitudinal loads are acting that are on the axis. So, members of the truss or frame transmit the load acting on the supports. So, the main thing which transfers the load is members of the truss. In transmitting this load, the members of the truss are either subjected to compressive stresses or tensile stresses. So these are the only two options what we have and what we need to analyze. So first of all, we'll talk about tension force. If the axial force in the truss members tends to pull or stretch its joints away from its pin, the force is called tensile force. So we can consider this as the member of the truss. Here is the force P, another is the force P. So this tends to pull the member. And so tensile stresses, or we can say tensile forces, are being developed in the member. And opposite of that, compression. If the axial forces in the truss members tend to push the joint towards its pin, the force is called compressive force. So here, opposite of the tensile force, if this is force P, this is again another force P, it will tend to compress the member, and compressive force, we can say compressive stresses, will be developed in the member. The members subjected to the compression are known as, we can say, strut or compression members. Because the angle of the member is not defined, we can call it strut. If it is at right angle, we can say compression member. So these are the terminology of the compression member. But if it is, the force is tensile force, we can say tensile member. Now let me illustrate you with the figure regarding this in detail. This is axial tension and this figure is for axial compression. Here the longitudinal axis for the member is given, where this red color represents the force which tends to pull the member, we can say rigid member, and tensile stresses are developed. So this tensile stresses, as shown in this dark green arrow, tends to oppose the motion, or we can say direction of the force. If the force is in tension, that is pushing away, then this arrow will be pulling them both towards each other. So it might be in the compression, but the stresses we call as tension stresses. It looks like compressive stresses. And opposite of that, internal stresses of a compression member are away from each other. That is opposing the red forces. These red forces are pushing towards each other, or we can say trying to compress the member, and the member stresses are trying to oppose it. So it is shown like this green arrow. So we need to remember this development of the stresses in the tension and compression member, where they try to oppose the action of the forces. So what we need to note here is these members are rigid and straight. Then and only then these reactions will be given, or we can say opposing stresses will be given. And these are the members of a truss. We can say truss members. that are stressed. Okay. So our next topic will be continuing with the assumptions made in the analysis of a plane truss. Here we go. So these are some of the assumptions which we need to take care about, or which we need to remember while analyzing a plane truss, that is finding out the stresses. When we talk about analysis of a plane truss, that simply means that we are finding the stresses of the truss members. Whether they are tensile or compressive, what are the magnitude of the each and every member stress, and whether the truss is perfect, imperfect, redundant or deficient. This is what the analysis of a plane truss means. So the assumptions which we need to remember are, first, all the joints are pinned joint. Yeah, we can say they are hinge, or we can say pinned. As per the definition of the truss, we have understood that the joints are pin joints. Second one is, the truss is loaded at the joints only. So as explained to you in the previous lectures, here we know that from the definition of the truss, these loads are acting only at the joints. See, this red one and this round are the joints of the truss. So this is the second assumption. The truss is loaded at the joints only. The third one is, the truss is a perfect truss. See, when we analyze any truss, we can say when we are finding the stresses in any member of the truss, we are assuming it to be perfect. M is equal to 2J minus R. This condition is satisfied. We have to assume this. Then the fourth assumption is, members are subjected to axial tension or compression. Again, as explained in this figure, the stresses are always axial, whether compressive or tension doesn't matter, but there are no any transverse load acting on it, and no shear force, bending moment or any transverse reactions are developed. Only axial tension and compression are acting on it. So this is the fourth assumption. Fifth one becomes, members of the truss are slender and straight. Here what do you mean by slender is thin members. Thin. This is the meaning of the slender. And straight. We can also say it as rigid. We are assuming it to be rigid. Slender, straight and rigid. So this becomes our fifth assumption. The sixth one is, self-weight of the members are neglected. So we are considering only the forces, external forces acting, and self-weights are neglected. So these are some of the assumptions which we need to remember. Recalling all the assumptions are, all joints are pin joints, yes. Loaded at the joints only. Truss is the perfect truss. Members are subjected to axial tension or compression. Members of the truss are slender, straight and rigid. And last one is, self-weight of the members are neglected. So this is it for the fourth lecture. In fifth lecture, we'll be continuing with methods of analysis of truss and methods of joint. And there we'll be solving examples. So till that time, continue reading and do watch all my videos.